welcome to MUFC Red Devil NCR's video. And we're going to be looking back at a very drab and a very disturbing Saturday for the way things turned out, and probably have a quick discussion on how we believe the Carabao fixture is going to go. Welcome, Ashley.
Hi, Mojo.
I guess neither of us are in a very good mood today, but that's the way it is at Manchester United right now, unfortunately.
It was a terrible Saturday. Still right. Very, very bad hangover from the game. I don't know. What are your thoughts on that? Did Ole get his tactics wrong for that game?
I mean, I'm looking at the game from four perspectives. One is the player's attitude.
Yeah.
You cannot possibly hide behind the fact that there were a few things which came out that, you know, I think it was Shaw who said that, you know, there's a quick turnaround between the previous season ending and this one beginning. But then that's the situation with all the other teams as well. Everybody, if you look at it, had 4 weeks off. And having 4 weeks off was known to everybody once the post-COVID matches started. So for us to come and say that, oh, look, we were not prepared and the fitness was not there, or we did not have enough preseason games. We just played one friendly. I mean, for Christ's sake, we lost that as well to Aston Villa. So it's like saying that we're finding excuses. So my first disconnect, if any, from Saturday was a big player, a big issue on players' attitudes. They just didn't turn up. Very reminiscent of the last six or seven games that Ollie had in his first season post getting a confirmation as being a Manchester United manager. The matches, once he got confirmed, were as drab as we played yesterday. We should have known that these teams, the so-called, I mean, Crystal Palace are amongst the top three or four right now. It's just been two matches of the season. But we've known the typical mid-table teams. The way they have played against United off late in the last two or three seasons is that they play with a very low block, and we are finding it difficult to break them down. So if that be the case, you know, that brings me to the team selection. Why was, for example, Dan James playing? Because Dan James is most effective when you are playing on a counter-attack. And we weren't playing on a counter-attack. It was rather Crystal Palace who was playing on the counter-attack, and that's how they got the third goal.
Exactly.
So Dan James playing on the right in a team which is, what, had something like 75-76% possession, made little sense. And time and again, I don't have the exact data points with me, but time and again, data points have showed us that Fred can do a better role as compared to McTominay when it comes to playing as a CDM. His breakup play is far better than McTominay's. Fred can break up the opposition play far better than McTominay can. So McTominay playing and James starting, and if there was an issue with regards to Van Bissaka not being fit enough post his quarantine on his return from Dubai, why was he on the bench at all? So it was a disaster waiting to happen, and then God behold what Lindelof and Maguire churned out. Oh man, I mean, I think they would have conceded goals to that defensive performance against a championship side as well.
That is why I fear for the Luton game.
Right.
Yeah.
So, I mean, coming to Luton. So, again, you know, whatever happens in Carabao, that's something that we'll come to in a while. But everybody on social media is on about Glazers out and Woodward out. Yes, I mean, those two are the main culprits for where we are right now.
Yeah.
But for Saturday, no matter what you say, our team was good enough to beat Crystal Palace, signings or no signings whatsoever. That team was good enough to beat Crystal Palace. You can't hide, as a Manchester United player, you cannot hide behind close season not being, you know, significantly long enough for you. It's not the manager's fault or the Premier League's fault that Harry Maguire goes to Greece and starts a police case against him. It's not the management's fault or Ollie's fault that despite knowing the quarantine rules, Arun Van Bissaka chooses to go to Dubai and do his holidays. And it's not Ollie's fault or Glazer's fault or whoever's fault that Greenwood knows he's an upcoming talent and then he goes and does whatever he did in Iceland and then other stories about him come out, you know, about smoking, you know, that banned substance or whatever. So it's been a bad off 1 month. And within that 1 month, what it also tells me is that we have let our players drift. We have not kept them focused, which I guess other managers have. And that leads me to believe how the current coaching staff or the team is helping these youngsters. It's all good to say that we want to build a young team of 21, 22-year-olds who are going to be at the club for 6-7 years. But then for a 21 or 22-year-old, you need to mentor them in a way that they realize their responsibility that they're playing for one of the biggest clubs in the world. You can't just go around, you know, behaving the way three or four of our players did in the offseason. And to come back and make those excuses that we didn't have enough games to get fit, I mean, other teams did. I mean, for the likes of Everton, Crystal Palace, for that match, teams to come out flying. I mean, the perennial chokers, I mean, they are almost sitting in the top four right now. And performances which, like you mentioned in our earlier videos, very reminiscent of how Arteta builds his team and prepares them. So,
very true.
Not only was the team selection not right, but it's just that our tactics on the day were not good enough either. And then, yes, it comes to the point that have been in place by now. Yes, they would have been, they should have been molded into the team by now. And now you have, I mean, it could be Sancho, it could be a Barashiel, it could be Telles, it could be whosoever you sign, are now going to be typical of those, you know, let's go to a crisis and get somebody in. What blows my mind off is, what are the likes of Matt Judge, who's responsible for giving the final go-ahead of who we sign? What are the people like this under Woodward, immediately under Woodward, doing at the club? You have 8 to 9 months to scout a player. You have 3 months to sign them on. 14 days to, you know, scratch your head and run around the out. Oh, we are in a crisis. Let's do something about it. That's exactly what happened last time. Had Bailly not got injured at the beginning of last season, I can 100% vouch for this, that this board would not have signed Maguire. And it's the same thing now. Had we gone ahead and beaten Crystal Palace very comfortably, all hold behold, you know, the board would have gone, look, you have brilliant players, your performance is really good, I don't think you need many signings. They'll probably give us another 15, 20 million pound signing and that's about it. Now, it's all helter-skelter. What the hell do we do? We're now left with only 10 to 12 days for the window to close.
Yes.
And yes. I'm 100% sure, apart from Sancho, if it happens, you know, discussing his or reading his name all over social media for the last 3 months, if that happens, I mean, no disrespect to Sancho. I mean, it's not his fault that our board is so... whoever we sign now is a crisis reaction. It's like, let's get somebody in, otherwise fans are going to rip everybody apart. Where is the planning in the entire club? I'm 100% sure the likes of Mourinho or the likes of Ollie would have given their first choice 5 or 6 players they wanted to strengthen in different positions. We come in, you haven't Dalo, Rojo's, it's all over the place. So Saturday's reaction for Glazers out and Woodward out is part of the problem, but Saturday's performance or the result was more of a, to a certain extent, Ollie's selection issue, which I am of the opinion that those players were played on those positions to let the board know, look, my bench strength is not good enough. And some of the images floating around social media were also showing how our attack was more driven from the left, wherein the likes of Lindelof and who was it? Who was playing on the right wing?
James.
I'm forgetting the name. Yeah. No, not James. Yeah, James. Yeah, James. And who was playing on the right
back? Right back, Fosu Mensah.
Yeah, Fosu Mensah, James, and how Lindelof were the only three players who were stuck in the right side of the field. And whereas the other eight were playing, or the other seven were playing more towards the left side. So that was the image which was doing the rounds on social media. I believe a lot of that selection was from Ollie's side to let the board know that, look, if you think I have squad depth, this is what I play, and look what happened. But parallelly, that team still was good enough to beat Crystal Palace or any of the teams, say, seven or eight below in the league table, to beat those teams easily. The players didn't turn up. I guess Ollie's tactics were a little confusing. And I guess the selection was more to do with letting the board know that I don't have the squad depth to be able to play players the way I want to. And fourth, yes, let's be honest, we should have had the likes of Telles in by now. We should have had the likes of one or two other positions, which I'm sure Ollie wanted to strengthen by now. That's where the board, Woodward, and the Glazers come in. So all in all, it was a nightmarish Saturday. And I don't know what holds for us in the next 14 days. I just hope we get Telles in. I was listening to another fan channel videos wherein they were again discussing the name of defender from what's that team?
Upamecano. Upamecano.
Like there's something going around about Badashil. Yes, Upamecano, and also Badashil in the last 10 to 15 minutes. So look, I don't know. I mean, I am. My weekend was screwed. All thanks to what happened. That's enough of a ranting from my side. up to you now. I mean, what do you believe?
I agree with everything you said. I agree with everything you said. I think he got the tactics absolutely wrong. What has happened is he sets his teams out now very one-dimensionally. There's nothing. Teams know that they are going to attack on the counter. What Crystal Palace did, tightened up the midfield. They tightened up the midfield. There was nothing happening from Manchester United's midfield going forward. Every ball that came to the midfield ended there. The move ended there. Pogba lost the ball, I don't know how many times. He was an absolute disgrace on the pitch. I do not know why.
Crazy.
I do not know why Ollie did not play Van der Beek in the first place. In fact, Van der Beek came out after the game and said, in practice, we were playing so much faster, but I don't know what happened at the game. We were playing so slowly. Bruno Fernandes has got this into his head now that he's a one-man army. Okay, that he can do everything. So he was going forward, midfield, as you said, retrieving the ball from Maguire, coming back. He's going to get tired. By the 70th minute, he's going to be out of it, out of gas. He can't keep doing that every game. Rashford, from the last game he played, has regressed even further. It is. I mean, I can lay money on it. The minute he reaches the box with the ball, he doesn't know what to do. He's lost the ball. He will stand, he will dither, and his mind is anywhere. He's not concentrating. He doesn't know whether to pass the ball, hold the ball, take a shot. I mean, I really don't know what is wrong with him, but he's regressed really badly. Rashford. Martial had an off day, but if days like this continue, I think we need to seriously look for a backup striker. Ighalo is not going to do the job, as I've said earlier, because there's no one to... He needs crosses into the box. There's no one to do that. He's a lost soul in the box, waiting for a ball to come in, which will never come. Our midfield, except Fernandes, wasn't operating at all. McTominay was really bad. The best player for Manchester United that day was Van de Beek for the little time that he was on the pitch.
Exactly. That's a very good point. Yes.
Maguire and Lindelof, as I had said before the game, were again absolutely lost on that pitch. They didn't know what they were doing.
Oh, man.
Lindelof, I think he should be left out of the team. I'm not talking of benched. He needs to be left out of the team. He wasn't Ollie's buy. But any defender for that ball would have put his foot out and try and stop the ball. Bailly, Mengi, anybody would have put his foot out to try and stop that ball. What made him not tackle? What made him not tackle?
He didn't do anything.
He didn't do anything. And
he did nothing.
Yeah, go ahead.
I mean, I was discussing with a friend of mine as well, and then we deviated on a discussion to a little thing about that episode with regards to VAR when the penalty was given. First, yes, it wasn't a penalty because the ball was literally 10 or 12 inches away from Lindelof. So for it to hit him from there on his arm, you would have to take that consideration that the proximity of the ball was very near to his body. But then for VAR to go ahead and not, let that save stand and let that penalty be taken again, because De Gea's foot was about an inch off the ground when the ball was struck.
But a rule is a rule.
It was just, I know, but it was just one of those days where it was disaster waiting to happen. It was just one after the other. You mentioned Martial. He just didn't have the service. I mean, it was literally... And you were bang on this point, and I again a salute to you on this. You said if Crystal Palace score, they're just going to sit there, park the bus, train or whatever, and they're just not going to let us play. And that's exactly what happened.
Exactly what they did.
And
this is the tactics used by the coaches.
Right, and coming to Rashford, I guess you correlate to whatever good work, and I mean, he's been brilliant off the field in terms of helping the poor, get their day meals and whatever the meal program that runs in the UK. He's been a brilliant ambassador and a brilliant front runner for that to be organized for that country. And somehow I think that's playing on his mind now. Because ever since all the praise and all the the positivity around his efforts to make sure that the UK government actually reverses its decision to continue the meals for the kids has happened, Rashford has got a lot of positive media and positive news around him, which is absolutely right, well deserved. But on the football field, ever since you look at those initiatives of his started getting recognition, his football has gone completely the way opposite. And it's still playing on his mind, and you're absolutely right. He doesn't know what to do with it, or it's more to do with the fact that Luke Shaw was not effective, as a result of which Rashford wasn't effective, because these two in tandem create a very strong left wing for us. So, I don't know what more to talk about Saturday. Just that it's can't even call it a bad dream. It's a very bad reality. And I just hope it's one of those things which doesn't happen again. But then, if you don't bring more players in, this will continue happening.
It's the current situation is a disaster waiting to get worse.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Imagine Lindelof and Maguire facing up to PSG and Bayern Munich attacks. Oh, God. Hell no, man.
Bayern Munich and PSG are another league altogether. I don't even want to think of what would happen if we played Bayern Munich with this team. But we don't need to go there.
Right.
Let them face Leeds. Let them face the Liverpools, the Cities, Chelsea.
I don't know what is going to happen
with this team if they play the way they did.
Oh, man.
As you said...
Man to man,
the players that were on the pitch, we should have comfortably beaten Crystal Palace. Plain and simple. There is
easily,
no getting away with that.
Yeah. I mean, we beat them away during post-COVID with almost the same team. And that too, and I think Crystal Palace game came up about three or four fixtures after the restart had happened. And we were exhausted. We didn't have the fluidity in that game either. But we came through with a 2-0 win because there was that willingness to get top four. I don't know with what willingness we got onto the pitch that day. It's just not there. And looking forward to Carabao, I mean, I would like to, you know, just open the bin and chuck Saturday in and then never open the bin again. But then till the signings happen and till we get into a decent run, and I'm fearing that decent run because after Brighton, we have Arsenal, we have Chelsea, we have Spurs, and we have Everton. So I'm fearing the worst if nothing happens in the next 14 days in terms of signings.
Look at the way that, you know, the first game that Spurs played, I said it was boring, and you know, sort of they were playing so badly. But the game, they won 5-2, didn't they win 5-2? Yeah.
Yes.
Four assists to the same player, four goals from Son, Harry Kane being the provider. Right. I mean, they are good players and they turned up and they played.
Right.
And that's what happens when your players turn up. And so you play in a system.
So let's hope they start turning up from Brighton onwards because they
have
tough and quick fixtures coming along. And that brings us to Carabao. I would say that if the likes of Luke Shaw have said that, you know, they didn't have enough time to prepare, I would say bloody go ahead and bench them all and bring on the people from the academy, get the likes of Lingard, Pereira, or who's ever playing. I mean, you win, fine, you win. You don't win, I don't give a damn for Carabao. For me now, the situation is that we seriously need to start tying up wins the way we did at the end of last season in terms of getting the confidence back. And Christ, we need players, man.
The top teams are not going to drop so many points. So every point matters. Every point matters. Right. That three points against Crystal Palace was very, very critical and crucial. And we dropped 3 points. Playing a brand of football I never want to see again.
Right.
Absolutely no cohesion between anybody. Absence of any tactics. There was no thought process. They just came onto the pitch without even knowing what they had to do as compared to Crystal Palace. They were so well set up in midfield. They broke every break Manchester United had was they stopped in midfield. Their forwards, they got the ball to Zaha. Zaha with the ball with Maguire and Lindelof. If you told me there was Zaha, Maguire, Lindelof and De Gea in the goal, I'd put my money on Zaha to score.
Exactly. And that's exactly what happened.
That's exactly what happened.
Yes.
So we need to show up our defense. Give the youngsters a chance. I mean, Bay is fit. Let Bay, Mengi, let Williams play at right back. Let Luke Shaw play at left back. Van der Beek, Bruno should start. Play Fred as a CDM. And Greenwood, Martial and Rashford, not for any reason, to let them get their confidence back. Right. Because this just looks like a hangover from the semi-final. They haven't recovered from that.
Right.
I think Lindelof is still mentally scarred. I think he needs to be rested. Give him a month off. Keep him off even the bench. But they should play Mengi.
I mean,
Mengi played just a few minutes of a couple of games last season. But even that was enough to show how good a player he is. I don't understand why they cannot see this. And let them play. Give them a chance. He would definitely not be worse than Lindelof. I guarantee you that, Mengi.
I mean, I'm 100% sure that's what I said. A lot of WhatsApp messages floating around since last 2 days. I would, at the current situation, if you're not able to get an Upamecano or a Badashil, in the current situation, I would rather keep Smalling because he would be far better than what Lindelof is putting out there.
That keeping Smalling in terms of being as good or better than Lindelof is not an argument per se at this point of time, because moving for Smalling will be taking two steps back. I'd rather blood a youngster.
Mm-hmm.
What you need in defense now is a fast, quick center back who can take on players one-on-one.
Right.
Maguire and Lindelof cannot. Neither are they quick out of defense. When you need that one touch, two touch, get the ball to your midfield or to your CDM and out. No, they cannot. They are unable to do it. They lose the ball. They cannot distribute the ball. They don't even tackling. They are unsure. They cannot defend set pieces. They cannot defend runners into the box. I don't know what the both of them are there for. Put in two young players or put in Bailly and another player. Put in Bailly and Mengi. But give them a chance. That ball which Lindelof should have tackled, Bailly would have gone for the tackle definitely.
Yes, 100%. 100%. So, let's hope we get these youngsters playing in the Carabao Cup.
You need to.
If these first teamers are, they don't have their heads switched on for the new season as yet, let them have another week off. I'm sure if you go towards a good run of games, if you can stitch up about 6 or 7 wins, or maybe say about 8 wins and 2 draws and about 7 wins or 3 draws together, then you are again, you know, looking back amongst, trying to get back to where you believe you should be at. So Carabao Cup should be all experimental. Give these supposedly the top 11 or 12 players a rest and let the reserves and your so-called bench strength play on Saturday. Oh, sorry, on the Carabao Cup. And let's hope for the best. But yes, for whatever tactics there were, for whatever the fact that the players didn't turn up, for whatever message that Ollie wanted to send out to the board, there's no hiding from the fact we need 3 signings. That is but obvious.
Now, the irony is that there's a rumor going around that Bielsa wanted James.
Yes.
I don't know how. Let me tell you this. If Bielsa gets James, he will be a totally different player at Leeds. I can guarantee you that.
Right.
We'll regret ever selling him or giving him out on loan or whatever.
Right.
His problem is in his head. James does not lack the ability. He has basic flaws which should not be there for a footballer of his standing and at the stage he is performing in. When you reach the box, you're running with the ball, your head is down. When you reach the box, the first thing you do, and any coach will tell you, even at a junior level, is look up and see where your players are. He doesn't do that. There was one instance, there were 7 Palace defenders. He's trying to kick the ball through them when Marcus Rashford was open. All he had to do was look up and pass the ball. Rashford was open. There was nobody marking Rashford, but he doesn't look up. And I think Ollie made this statement last year in one of the press conferences where we had won that game, but could have scored more. And he said that these forwards, when they reach the box, they don't look up. So they don't know where their players are.
Right.
These are things which have to be corrected. Now, this is a problem which has been happening from last year, from the last season. Why is it still happening again? Why doesn't someone take him aside and clear his head and tell him that this needs to be done? He's got the pace. He has the skill. But it's of no sense when you reach the box and you, again, like Rashford, you don't know what to do with the ball. The ball is being kicked into a crowd of 5 people. It's never going to go anywhere. What is he doing? Wishing for a deflection into the goal? It's not going to go anywhere. Look for your players or loop the ball over those players. But he's just not doing it.
That's where I guess one of these days we'll have to have a chat over how our current coaching setup is helping develop players as well, because all through the entire coaching ranks, apart from what's his name? I'm forgetting his name. Who was also coaching along with Sir Alex,
Mick Phelan.
Apart from him, I don't think there is anybody there who really has the experience of developing players. And that's where I fear for Ollie. I mean, even if you get given players, he seriously needs to start looking at player development over the period of time. But I'm sure that that's a longer discussion we'll get into. Let's just hope we turn up for the Carabao game and for the Brighton game. By then, hopefully, we should have about two or three signings in place. A Barachil or a Upamecano or a Telles or a Sancho. I mean, we definitely short of three players. Let's hope what we have seen on Saturday, we do get the signings in.
Like Ollie said, there's still
37 games to go. So there's still a lot of the season to recover. It's just the first game. But unless you get new signings, unless you freshen it up, these tactics and these game plans will have us go through a very rough 2020-21.
How many games are Liverpool or Man City going to lose in the season? Is what you need to ask yourself. I'm talking about Ollie.
Right. So I've been of the opinion that I don't think this season is going to be anywhere about 97-98 points to win the title. I guess it's going to be about 10 or 12 points lesser. But my only worry is, and you cannot discount that, and it's not to do with one or two players that he signed, but an Ancelotti factor at Everton in a full season, it's going to have them play far better than what they ever did. And they've, yes, made some very interesting signings as well. So, you know, I just hope we get the players in the next 10 to 12 days. And I just hope we start clicking, because Saturday was a drab. And if our players need rest, so be it. Don't play them on Carabao. Play the academy guys and some of the bench people. And we go from there.
Yes, just let's hope for the best. But even winning that game should not take anything away from the crisis that is staring at us in the face. Yes.
No, absolutely not.
Yes. I blame the owners for not taking in any initiative to buy new players. But again, as we said earlier, are they waiting to see whether Ollie can actually deliver with the players we have? Because the players we have are not short of any talent at all.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
They gave him who he wanted last year, Van Bissaka.
Right.
James and Maguire. But Van Bissaka and Maguire, all three of them have regressed this season, for whatever reason.
Right.
As you said earlier, Maguire going off on a Greek jaunt, Van Bissaka going off to Dubai, James again not performing up to expectations. Now, these are the three players he's bought, the three players aren't performing. They give him money to buy new players. Will those players perform?
Right.
Sancho is not going to make Maguire or Lindelof look better.
Sure.
They are going to be as bad as they are. Scoring one goal and leaking three goals doesn't make sense. You have to shore up your defense.
And the goal we scored was quite lucky as well.
Lucky,
it came off a Palace defender and Van de Beek knocked it in. But I believe when you say that the board is waiting for all, to actually come to a point where they can be comfortable that Ollie can be back with more signings. I mean, he's got his top three. Top four last season. Yeah, top three, yes, because he finished third. But then he also got us to three semifinals. So I would say that, yes, there is progress there. And to back that progress, you needed new players to come in. We all know this, that our bench is nowhere near good enough. And if the board is sitting here and thinking, let's not back Ollie. We've given him four players. Let us just presume that he's going to get into Champions League again this season. I'm sorry, that's not going to happen.
It is.
Because every single club have got their signings in place well in time before the season kicked off. And I would say a good dozen of them would still sign a player or two before the transfer window closes. So we better get our act together, give Ollie the players. Yes, Ollie has been found tactically once or twice in previous season as well. He'll get that right as he moves along. But the players' attitude on Saturday and the board messing up on not giving Ollie the signings is the main reason why Saturday happened. But I presume the Saturday won't happen in the fixtures coming up, because I believe that these players will turn up. I believe that we'll be given a couple of new signings, a couple or three at best. And I just hope we turn it around, because I'm fearing those four fixtures back to back: Spurs, Arsenal, Chelsea and Everton.
The board needs to back him, definitely. I agree fully. But he also needs to get his players motivated. He also needs to get his games tactically correct. Right. The board needs to get rid of the deadwood. If they are, right, as they say, from a purely business point of view, paying such high salaries to people who are never going to play a football match doesn't make sense.
Right.
Sell the deadwood. If you don't want to buy so many new players, at least get more academy players on the bench.
Right.
Put, expose more academy players. But yes, it's got to be from now. They've all got to work together. The board needs to support Ollie with at least three signings. That is definite. They need to shore up the defense. They need a center back, left back, and a right winger. Right winger to cover, yes, for Greenwood. Midfield. Right. The midfield is sorted. Ollie needs to motivate his players. He needs to get his tactics right. I think all these together are going to work to our advantage going forward with these games. And the players have to all turn up. As you said, they all have to turn up for every game. Or we are looking at, with this team and the way they are playing, we are not going to progress in the Champions League. The way they are playing, unless they pull their socks up.
We'll probably finish bottom of the
group. We'll probably land up in the Europa League again.
So I just hope we don't. I would rather prefer that if you are really going to get knocked out of the Champions League, you totally get knocked out of Europe altogether, because then you only focus on the Premier League.
Yeah. But getting new signings is a must. Getting new signings, making them work for you. For example, you had Van de Beek on the bench, but you allowed a underperforming Pogba to play 70 minutes or 60 minutes of that game. Why? If he's not playing properly, if he's suffering the after effects of an illness or for whatever reason, take him off.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. You have bought a player who is waiting to come on the pitch, who has the ability, bring him on. Why do you keep him? He came on and in 5 minutes he scored a goal.
Mm-hmm.
So he tactically needs to get these things right. Players, if Pogba is playing badly, keep him off. It's plain and simple. Get the right players on the pitch. If Rashford isn't performing, change it around. Play Martial on the left, play Gallo in the middle, play Greenwood on the right, whatever you have to do. But you can't keep them on the pitch when they are playing badly. And that is what he was doing. He didn't even change McTominay. McTominay had a horrible game.
Exactly. Why was he on for the entire 90 minutes is beyond me.
Precisely. So these are things I don't understand. Yes, the board is to blame where the signings are concerned. I agree completely. We need to get signings. They need to support Ollie where that is concerned. But again, Ollie too needs to get his act together on the pitch. Because some of his tactics and some of the players he puts on the pitch, it's really baffling. I cannot understand why he does that. If you have your best 11 available, play them. That's it. I can understand if it's a Carabao Cup, FA Cup or something like that. But in the Premier League, play your best team.
Right. Anyway, look, let's hope it happens. Let's hope we get the signings done. Let's hope players start turning up and start playing for the badge. Again, as usual, thanks, Ashley, for your time.
Thanks, Mojo. It's been great to be here.